staat de koffie en thee voor u klaar.
Dank u wel.
Bijna.
Goedenavond. Oh, ik vind het altijd zo spannend dit allemaal. Of jullie er allemaal wel in passen, maar jullie passen er allemaal in. 750 ouders en studenten, van harte welkom. Fijn dat u er bent. En ook een warm welkom voor alle ouders die vanavond, die vanuit het buitenland vanavond met ons meekijken. En voor hen loopt achter mij de ondertiteling mee. Ik heb het gezien. U heeft kinderen. Ik heb ook kinderen. En wat wij allemaal willen is dat onze zonen en dochters een goede toekomst tegemoet gaan. Dat ze gewoon goed terechtkomen. En daar zijn we mee bezig als ouder vanaf het moment dat ze naar de basisschool en vervolgens naar de middelbare school gaan. En u werd door die scholen bij hun ontwikkeling en hun keuzes zeer betrokken. Ja, en dan? Ik weet het zelf nog heel goed. Toen mijn oudste dochter alweer meer dan 10 jaar geleden naar het hbo ging. En de boodschap was eigenlijk: laat los. Ze staat nu op eigen benen en je hebt als ouder geen bemoeienis meer met haar studie. Ik vond die abrupte overgang toen echt niet fijn. Want je wilt toch betrokken zijn bij het nieuwe leven van je kind. En sterker nog, wij van de Hanze Hogeschool vinden dat dat moet en dat uw betrokkenheid een van de belangrijke factoren is voor studiesucces van uw kind. En daarom organiseert de Hanze Hogeschool in oktober voor alle ouders van alle eerstejaarsstudenten deze avond. Met als doel dat wij u vanavond meenemen in de nieuwe wereld van uw zoon of dochter. Studeren aan het hbo. Ik begin met u een vraag te stellen. Wie van u weet welke tentamens uw zoon of dochter de komende periode heeft en welke opdrachten af moeten en wanneer? Niemand? Kom op, steek die vinger eens op. U weet het niet? Weet u of er überhaupt gestudeerd wordt? Voor een 6 of voor een 8? Ik krijg geen antwoord. Voor ons is die eerste tentamenperiode een eerste belangrijke meting. En dat kan twee kanten opgaan. Allereerst studenten die een 8 of een hoger halen. Deze studenten vallen ons op. Dat zijn talenten, studenten die boven het maaiveld willen uitsteken, misschien wel onze toekomstige onderstudenten. Maar ook de andere kant op. Studenten die een onvoldoende hebben behaald. Komt dat omdat ze niet hard genoeg gewerkt hebben of dat ze misschien erg moeten wennen aan het andere systeem van leren? Gelukkig is er voor hen nog geen man overboord. Er is gelegenheid om het vak nog 1 keer te herkansen. Kern van mijn verhaal is vanavond: hoe kunnen uw zoon en dochter en wij en u als ouder er in gezamenlijkheid voor zorgen dat we elkaar in 2021 weer zien bij de diploma-uitreiking? Allereerst moet u weten dat het studeren aan de hogeschool heel anders is dan het leren op de middelbare school of het mbo. In principe is de student zelf verantwoordelijk voor zijn studiesucces. En dat betekent dat de student zelf zijn studie plant en organiseert. En dat is wennen. Sommigen pakken dat zo op en anderen hebben wat langer tijd nodig. En daarom is er vanuit de opleiding met name veel begeleiding en sturing, ook sturing in het eerste jaar. Iedere klas heeft een studieloopbaanbegeleider of een mentor waar uw zoon of dochter steeds terecht kan met allerlei vragen. En de studieloopbaanbegeleider praat ook regelmatig met uw zoon of dochter over de studievoortgang. Zeker als straks na het eerste blok echt niet goed is gescoord. Een ander verschil met de middelbare school of het mbo is dat de hoeveelheid lesstof die er voor een tentamen moet worden geleerd echt veel groter is. En de praktijk leert dan ook dat als een student niet direct begint met het studeren aan het begin van een blok, en we hebben 4 blokken in een jaar, de kans groot is, ja, dat hij het tentamen of de opdracht niet haalt. En wij doen er alles aan om de studenten dat besef bij te brengen. Nog een verschil met een middelbare school is dat uw kind hier wordt opgeleid voor een beroep. En daar hoort professioneel gedrag bij. En wij spreken hen daar ook op aan. Op tijd komen moet je later ook op je werk. Ook samenwerken en plannen, feedback kunnen geven en ontvangen en professioneel met elkaar en de faciliteiten omgaan. Wat u ook moet weten is dat een student hier gedurende zijn studie, nou u weet het, studie duurt 4 jaar, heel veel keuzes moet maken. En dat begint zeker ook al in dit eerste jaar. Ik hoop het niet, maar misschien heeft u er nu al mee te maken dat uw zoon of dochter hardop heeft durven te zeggen: papa en mam, ik ben er eigenlijk niet meer zo heel zeker van of de opleiding zo wel bij mij past. Stoppen? Iets anders gaan doen? Of dat uw kind rond de kerst van zijn SLB'er het advies krijgt om te stoppen met de studie, omdat wij er dan al niet meer in geloven dat hij voldoende studiepunten haalt in het eerste jaar, of dat de inzetmotivatie echt veel te laag is. En deze dingen gebeuren en horen bij 17, 18-jarigen die nog volop aan het zoeken zijn en midden in hun ontwikkeling staan, of gewoon het nieuwe studentenleven in de stad Groningen veel en veel te leuk vinden. En daarom stopt ook ieder jaar ongeveer 25% van de studenten in het eerste jaar. En dat geldt voor alle opleidingen van de Hanze Hogeschool. En landelijk ligt dat percentage nog hoger. En wij zeggen dan: ga thuis serieus aan de praat. Ga het gesprek aan. En als het echt niet gaat, laat je dan uitschrijven van de opleiding. Maar het kan ook zijn, en dat gebeurt gelukkig in de meeste gevallen, dat uw kind zegt: ik vind het hartstikke leuk op mijn opleiding. Ik vind het een mooi beroep en sterker nog, de behoefte heeft om in de 4 jaar niet alleen te studeren, maar ook andere belangrijke ervaringen op te doen. En voor die studenten zijn er heel veel kansen om het allerbeste uit zichzelf te halen. Zijn talenten optimaal te ontplooien en zelfs uit te willen blinken. En wij zouden graag zien dat u dat stimuleert. Zo kan uw zoon of dochter geselecteerd worden voor het Hanze Honors College, of studentassistent worden, of in het bestuur gaan zitten van een van onze studieverenigingen, of deel gaan uitmaken van de medezeggenschap, of een periode in het 3e of in het 4e jaar gaat studeren of stage gaat lopen in het buitenland. En bij het maken van al die keuzes spelen wij natuurlijk een belangrijke rol, maar ook uw rol is belangrijk. Betrokkenheid, klankbord, gesprekspartner zijn van uw zoon of dochter is heel belangrijk. Tot slot. Wij nemen u mee vanavond in de nieuwe wereld van uw kind. Een wereld die opleidt voor een beroep in de communicatie, in de ICT, in de mediasector of de creatieve industrie. Waarbij uw zoon of dochter begeleid wordt door docenten, vakmensen die heel vaak zelf het beroep nog in de praktijk uitoefenen. Ik wens u allen een leuke, leerzame avond toe onder begeleiding van de studenten. Waar sta je? Daar staan ze. En daar staan ze. Geweldige studenten uit ons PR-voorlichtingsteam. En geef ze een warm applaus.
Good evening, everyone. A very welcome to you on this parent evening. This is the program for the game design students. So if you, like our colleague are in the wrong room, please speak up now, because this is what we are going to. We're going to give you a little peek inside what it's like to study here. So we're going to give you a lot of information, and afterwards we will going to show you what we teach our students by having a small workshop. But first, let us introduce ourselves. My name is Henriette Eilander. I'm the program manager of this program.
And good evening. My name is Arjan van Houwelingen. I'm one of the lecturers at our major in our study. I'm a psychologist by trade, and I make tabletop games, and that knowledge I use both fields of knowledge I use during the study.
Good evening. My name is Niek Jonker. I'm also a lecturer here at the Hanse University. I'm a part-time teacher and a part-time entrepreneur, so I have my own company in game development, and I teach students all sorts of different trades about projects and how to work together.
We're going to talk English this evening. I don't know if you expected this, but of course it is an international program. We have lots of international students. This year we had an intake of over 50% of non-Dutch students. That is also why we are filming this today, because a lot of parents couldn't make it, of course, due to, well, you can figure out the reasons. And that's why we're filming it, so that we can make a nice clip of it, so that people can watch it from afar. That's also why we use the microphone. So if you want to ask us questions, please do, and we'll repeat the question so that it's also available for the people at home. The program is called Communication and Multimedia Design, which is a lot of text. We have basically three majors. Game design, that's our international program. That's what we're here for this evening. But we also have a program called Interaction Design and a program called Visual Design. So they're all connected to interactive media, but they all cover a different field. If you join here as a student of game design, you will get your program and also your classmates and your teachers connected to game design from the start. What is it about? Well, I think most of you were on an open day at some point last year, visiting this school, maybe even this room. Designing and developing games for a specific purpose or player experience, that's what the short version of the program is about. And Ian is going to explain a little bit more about that.
Quick question. How many of you do play games? And I'm not talking about the big online games, but maybe also small card games, mobile games, Word Feud. That's a lot of fingers. That's a lot of fingers. So apparently something, playing games is something we like, whether it's for social activity together with friends and family, as a nice distraction, escapism. But there's a broader sense of emotions and experience it can give. And you see now that more and more games also become into the realm of culture. It's not just entertainment. It actually gives a deeper experience. You can experience sadness, fear, loss. Those emotions are also triggered by games. So that tells us it's a powerful medium. So we like to use that power of games and create experiences for players, not only for entertainment, but especially also to see how can we apply that power. Whether it's in an educational game, a game where you learn something, practice something in a nice way, and harness the power of play. That's what we do at our major. At our study, we also look at a broader application of multimedia. We live in a digital world these days. So at our study, we also focus at websites, apps. Students get to know virtual reality and augmented reality, and they'll be ready to use any new technology that comes up. We might not know what will be out there, but we want to make sure that our students are ready to experiment with it and make tools for it that are really useful. So, what does that mean? Well, it means that we want to get them ready for the future, and of course it also means making them aware of what are the jobs, what are kind of jobs are out there, and prepare them for those. Jobs you can think of that you can find in this field are a game designer, a game artist, game developer, focusing on interaction development, design, being an entrepreneur, some students really like to start their own company, and we do want to give them a heads up. What does that mean? What skills do you need? And make them ready for it. Besides all the skills and tools they'll get, we also focus on a few fields. We believe that students need to be ready to be a creative designer, so that's one of the fields we give a lot of experience in. The same with design research. If you want to make a game, an application with a certain intent, you also need to know what's going on. For example, a game about health, what autism, a game for autism and learning how to communicate better. What does that mean? What should the game do? You need to do research for that. As I said, new technology is an important part, and we want to bring them a certain attitude and entrepreneurship that's really useful in this field. Make sure they are independent, proactive, communicate well, have an intercultural awareness. As you can imagine, that's even more important if you are working together with students from other cultures, and also the working field is quite international. Going to our program. We're in year one now, Serious Game Design and Development. Currently, students are having a project to make a game on intercultural awareness. After this first half year, they will also get the basics of interaction design and visual design to encompass the whole field of multimedia design. In year two, we'll offer them a program geared towards virtual reality, immersion game design, and in Game Lab, they will make a game for a client. And we'll show you some examples later on of what you can expect that they can make. Really stuff, nice stuff happens in there. Year three is about internship and minor, and year four is about working on a very innovative, demanding project and graduation. So year two is about your focus on major. If the students like to continue in game design, they can continue in that major. But there's still an option to switch to visual design or interaction design. And in year three, the internship placement, it can be in the Netherlands or abroad. We do want to facilitate and stimulate more international experience. And also the minor you can do abroad. So your son or daughter might come up and ask, look, I really want to go to Japan or Finland. We've seen it happen. I already told a little bit about what they're doing right now. Project game design, they're learning the starts of digital design, design thinking and concepting, skills and tools and techniques you need to create interactive, creative prototypes, play with tech, of course, learning what technology is, programming. That's all part of our curriculum.
Of course, it's a demanding program. It's a lot. It's a big change for most students. Once you come here, it's completely different than your secondary school. It might be completely different than what you were used to at home. A lot happens. A lot of our students, especially our game design students, of course, don't live at home anymore. They come here, some immigrate to come here. So it's a lot of changes, a lot of things going on in their lives. And on top of that all, we have a demanding program, which is a lot to deal with. But of course, and lucky for them, we also know that. And we have some compassion. That's why we also have an elaborate network to support your son and daughter in the first year, but also after that. But we know that most important is getting started here in the program. So we have teaching staff. Well, that figures. We have a lot of teachers who have worked in game design, who are entrepreneurial, have entrepreneurial skills, who have worked in the field, who know what they're talking about, and who can show and tell students what it's like. That really helps, usually, to motivate students. We have counselors, academic counselors, and I will name them in a short while. Each class has its own academic counselor. And that's one of the staff members that is especially there to talk to them, to talk about their study progress, to talk about how they get along in this program, what they encounter for differences, to help them sort out the ways within the Hanse Hogeschool, but also within the program. Very important, at least every block, the academic counselor talks to each and every individual student next to having classes with them. So sometimes their own subject, but also extra classes on topics like How do you go about research? How do you go about enrolling yourselves in OSIRIS, our grade system? All these kind of difficult things. We have academic counselors that really help your son and daughter getting started with these questions, because it can be really difficult at times. Next to that, we have educational support. We have a whole network of people who are used to working with people from other countries and first-year students, and who can help students with questions about tuition fees, enrollment in StudiLink, all these kind of things. We have a very elaborate network for that as well, because it happens. There's a lot of questions because it's a very difficult system at times. We have program managers like myself, people that can that help students evaluate the program. Every block, we sit down with class representatives to talk about the quality of the program, to talk about the quality of the teachers, to see if we need to make adjustments and if a class is still on track and feeling okay. That's very important, of course. Then we have the dean of the school. Well, she's in the back and you just met her. That's also very important, because we also need to look out for our facilities, making arrangements for the student associations, and making sure that everything is geared towards having a good education here, because that's what, of course, we are all about. We have an exam board. And the exam board is something that you don't encounter every day, I hope, because the exam board is there if there are conflicts, if there is a student that cannot perform the way he or she would like to because of illness or personal reasons, then the exam board can help and make extra arrangements for students if they need them. And we have lots of other committees, like, for instance, the student associations, like all sorts of advisory boards that students can join and help us make the education either more fun or better, or both, ideally. In under Dutch law, we are not allowed to select students at the gate. In higher education, like this program, we are only allowed to select students if we are an art school or sports, those very specific programs. But in a broad program like ours, we are not allowed to select students at the gate. And that's completely different than in other countries, for instance, where they can select the students with the highest grades, for instance, or by motivational letters or whatever. So the Dutch law says everyone that has a half diploma or equal can enter any program of higher education in the Netherlands, because the first year needs to be geared towards orientation and selection. Orientation, because the student has to find out whether game design is really actually what he or she thinks it is and whether it's to his or her liking. I mean, maybe you find out during the first year that you thought it was completely different, or that it's better than you expected, or that you think maybe you should be in a more ICT-related program, or all sorts of things can happen. But that's the purpose. The purpose of the first year is to make sure that the student has the chance to see whether this profession is something that he or she would like to do, and yeah, most ideally that you can envision yourselves doing in 4 years, and you think, oh, I could be like Nick. I could be like him in a few years. But it's very important. It's important that you get to work with the projects that are lifelike, that are really real, like they would be once you enter the profession, so that you really can figure out whether this program fits your needs and your desires, of course. On the other hand, since we cannot select at the gate, the Dutch law says that we are allowed to select in the first year. And we call that the negative binding study advice. Well, the word advice is a little bit throws you off point, because it's not an advice. It is really like that. So in the first year, you can obtain 60 credits. And at the end of the first year, so at your first year of studying, so in June, for instance, you need to have obtained at least 48 out of those 60 credits. That is, of course, if you haven't been ill or had any dramatic experiences. I mean, that's not fair, of course. We have to play the game like it should. So if you were healthy studying and you manage to obtain over 48 credits, then we say, well, look, you showed us that you can manage your program, show perspective, we'd like you to stay on. If you cannot make the 48 credits, then the reasoning is, well, then it's going to be very hard for you to finish this program in 5 or 6 years, so please reconsider whether this is your program. For every subject that we offer and every test, you have 2 opportunities within the first year. And of course, this rule only applies if you were a healthy, happy student. If you had really horrible things happening to you or you were ill during one of the exam periods, that's of course not the way we play the game. Then you can go to the exam board, and then the exam board usually says that you are exempted from that rule. But it is the rule that we take very seriously. So in the first year, you need to obtain at least 48 credits out of the 60. But you have a lot of rights too. We want to play this game fairly, so that means that we also have a teaching and examination regulation. Well, it's a bit law-like, it's a horrible document to read, I'm afraid, but it does give you insight in what the rules and regulations are within the program. So it might be very handy to look it up one day and see what happens. Usually students only look it up when there's something wrong. And then, of course, your academic counselor can also help you with that one. The academic counselor. Well, we have some here today. We don't have everyone here today because some of them had other obligations, but we'll introduce them to you. The first class is called CMV1A and has as an academic counselor Mitchell Bonema, who couldn't make it tonight. 1B has got Nick Jonker. Nick? Just a and then 1C, we have Thomas Moak. Yeah, I see fans. And I see Douwe's alone at the coffee side of the window. Come in, Douwe. That's how it opens. Any people in Douwe's class here tonight? Yeah. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay. And 1E is Ian van Houwelingen. Yeah, we have 1 student here from Ion. Oh, see, Geert also, very good. And we have Odette. Woo! 1F. And last but not least, Loes Damhoff, who couldn't be here tonight. And of course, Rineke. Anyone from Rineke's class? Yeah, 1. Okay, thank you. What did he do once again? They are the staff members to talk to. And of course, most of the students here tonight are over 18. And by law in the Netherlands, sometimes the law is handy, we are not allowed to give any information about your son and daughter because they are mature for the Dutch law. So we can't tell anything about grades or behavior or these kind of things. But of course, if your son and daughter is there, we can say something about what it's like. The academic counselor is also there to help to make the right choices. Hey, a lot of students are at one point in the first year a bit stressed about all the exams coming at them, or they suddenly realize that they started too late working period, so that they have a lot of work to do still, especially subjects like programming can really come up and haunt you if you haven't done it regularly every week. Then at the end, it's suddenly a lot. And the academic counselor also discusses the study process with your son or daughter. And so how are you doing? Are you getting your grades in? Are there any problems that prohibit you from studying? Do you know when the resits are? So it's really geared towards the individual needs. We also have a program connected to it. It's called Meet Your Future, and it means that we invite people from the working field to say something about their profession, about what they're doing, how they got there, and what they like and don't like about their job, in order to inform the students on what is out there, what's there after you got your diploma. What can you do then? What kind of jobs? And that's very interesting in this field because a lot of jobs haven't been invented yet. because it's such a growing field. And we see a lot of new jobs popping up, new job titles also. Last week I saw a survey among alumni of the national platform, and I thought that in the last year over 40 new job titles popped up among the alumni of the Communication and Multimedia Design program. So people were inventing their own jobs in a company and inventing their own job titles as well. That's how new the world of creative technology is. Yeah? That's how fast things are moving forward. So that's also interesting. What will your job title be? We also have a lot of class meetings to talk about these things, to talk about how the class is working together, because the best support that you can have as a student is good classmates. And because we work a lot in groups, and then it really helps if you can get along with your classmates and if your classmates support you and help you out on a rainy day, because that's the best system that you have. And we have a lot of assignments. We don't have that many written exams. That's very interesting in our program. 3 in first year in total, which is not a lot, but we do have a lot of assignments. Group assignments, individual assignments. Show us what you do. Show us what you mean. Explain why you did what you did. And make professional projects for us as soon as possible. As I said, we also have professionals, and those are called the study counselors. Those are the decanen in Dutch. Those are the people who are usually qualified psychologists who can help students with either disabilities. A lot of dyslexic people study here, for instance, who can help people with handicaps, who can help people who are suddenly in mental stress, or people with financial problems even. We have all sorts. And those people are specialized in helping students further with really serious, interesting questions about their own study and can help them. We also have extra psychologists and training for students that have difficulty to perform or are very nervous about studying. There are all sorts of extra backup classes that we organize for those students. And last but not least, we also have language support. For a lot of our students coming in, it's not that difficult to speak English and to write English, especially writing. But a lot of students overestimate themselves, so we have a lot of support, especially in the first period, for getting to improve your English and to improve your writing, and especially your professional writing in that language. And we keep on doing that till the fourth year, till the last day of your graduation, I'm afraid, because some people really need that support, extra support. But we offer that as well. As Trini already told you, our dean, in her interview, we also have an extra program. So not for the students who find it too difficult, but for the students who think, is this it? I can do better. I can do more. I want more challenges. For them, we have invented the Honors Talent Program, because we really want to stimulate students that want to make the most of their studies here and who can do something extra. The Honors Program means that after year one, you can get selected for that program, and it means that you will do 30 credits extra on top of your year 2, year 3, year 4. So in total, you will not do 3 years, but 3.5 years in credits. And you will have an extra program with other students from this institute mixed together. Very interesting, challenging assignments from people in the working field, companies, organizations, non-governmental organizations usually, that give interesting assignments to mixed groups of students. So it's a really extra level for those who feel challenged by such a program. And of course, we are very glad and very proud. I'm looking at Robin now because he's one of those proud members of GLITCH. GLITCH is our study association connected to the GAME program. GLITCH is not there just for fun. It's also there for education. They do a lot of useful workshops and interesting trainings. In January, we're going to organize the Global Game Jam, location Groningen, one of the biggest in the Netherlands. Always good fun. So they're really there to give something extra to this program, not just for fun. We also have a PR and promotion team, and as you can tell by their orange polos, they are also a member there. Geert and Robin are also a member of the promotion team. That means that on open days, for instance, but also this last weekend we had Spannend Zernike. That's a big project in this city to stimulate young kids. I mean, they were 8, 9, 10, something like that, to be interested in technique, since we really need more people that are into technology. And they had this great workshop there on virtual reality. So we also look for people there. So that might also be a way to enrich your studies here, to join up for one of our teams. And then we have the official committees, like the student, the class representatives, for instance, but also the participation council, and all sorts of student panels that we ask to look at a program and discuss it with us. So there are all sorts of ways to do extra in this program, either get paid for it or just for fun or just for the learning experience of it. And then, well, we're almost halfway through the first year. No, we're not. But we are on a quarter, so it always looks, the first period is always the busiest one with the most students. But it means in 3 years' time, most of you will have that degree, and then what's out there? That's very interesting, especially in this work field, because there's a lot of changes going on, a lot of new developments. We see a lot of people who are short in small companies. We see a lot of people moving into ICT companies. So a lot of possibilities. And we will get to that in a moment. But first, we'll ask if there's questions so far. Any things that you want to ask us? Then we're going to show you something. We're going to show you something about our program. I think we're going to start with something that you can explain.
So in year two, as I showed, students have a game lab in which they make a game and really develop it. And I want to showcase the results of one team that worked together with the ambulance services to make something to treat burn wounds.
Together with Ambulance Zorg Groningen, we developed a simulation for paramedics in which they can train themselves to handle stress. This simulation involves children with severe burn wounds. This case is very rare and thus hard to train in any other way. We have had multiple testing sessions with the paramedics because their opinion is paramount. The responses were very positive.
The key features of this simulation are voice recognition, unique responses and burn wound generation. The voice recognition is used to obtain player input, and for every situation there is a unique response from either the father, the mother, who is stressed or maybe angry. The burn wound generation means that the burn wounds will be generated on the victim's body to create a unique experience every single time you will play our simulation. Has to be realistic but not photorealistic, because we are aiming for an immersive situation in which the paramedics will feel stress. Therefore, the burn wounds don't have to be photorealistic, since they can train this with actual photos instead of with this game. This also goes for the rest of the scene. As long as the movements and the voice acting are realistic, this should be enough to give a certain feeling of stress. project has been a true experience. You have no clue how much fun developing a professional serious game for the HTC Vive can be. This, in combination with the narrow cooperation with the Ambulancezorg, gives opportunity to get a close look in their work field as well. In short, we loved working on this project, and we have learned a whole lot regarding becoming a serious game developer.
So you saw a case of students making something for a client, having to think about how to create an experience for paramedics that they can train in a way that is still nice and educative. We also want to give the word to Robin to show something he made while being abroad.
So yeah, I'm Robin ten Wolde. I'm a fourth year. Last year I spent a full year in Finland as part of my internship and my minor. I made a game there called Overtowered. I'll explain a little bit about how the game, Oulu Game Lab works, but let's first watch how you actually play Overtowered.
In Overtowered, you play as a wizard whose neighborhood got destroyed. The other wizard, played by your opponent, thinks you did it and wants revenge. Quickly rebuild your tower, send out your minions, and try to destroy the other tower. Be sure that your opponent's minions don't reach you though. Your tower can only sustain so many attacks before it collapses. Before you start a game, you have the option to choose a wizard. Each wizard takes different tower pieces with them into the game, with which they can build their tower. These pieces could spawn units, cast spells, or provide utility. Once you've chosen your wizard, you can start the game. Building your tower is easy and is done in the bottom left window. Just left click on the blinking squares. A radio menu will appear with 6 different tower pieces. These pieces depend on which wizard you selected before the game starts. Each costs a certain amount of magic. You can see your magic meter right here. If you have enough magic for a tower piece, simply click on it and the tower piece will be instantly built. Keep in mind that certain tower pieces provide adjacency bonus to other pieces. When such a bonus is active, you can see an arrow point from the source to the affected tower piece. If you're not happy with a particular tower piece, then you can empty the location by right-clicking on the room and clicking empty. This won't cost you anything, but you don't get anything in return either. Units are key to destroying your opponent's tower, so it's important to have units at hand. You spawn units by building unit pieces. Once built, these pieces will regularly spawn a corresponding unit every so often. You can control when they spawn by clicking the pause and play button above the tower building window, or by clicking on an individual room. When a room is paused, the unit will still build but not spawn. Only when a piece is unpaused will the unit spawn. Once your units have left your tower, you have no direct control over them. They will head for the opponent's tower via the quickest available route. Certain levels have different ways of controlling where your units go. In a level here, for example, you can summon a bridge to create a shortcut. The bridge will glow in the color of the player that owns it. Only their units can cross. If you want to cast a spell, you will first need to build a tower piece that corresponds with the spell. Once the piece is built, click on it and click on the location where you want to cast it. If you click on a spell but have decided not to cast it, simply right-click anywhere to stop casting it. Once cast, a piece must recharge and cannot cast anything. When it is done charging and ready to be used again, the room will start flashing. Building more of one type of spell piece gives you more use for that spell. After all, if one is recharging, you still have 2 rooms left to activate.
So yeah, that's Overtowered. So the Oulu Game Lab, which is in Finland, in the north of Finland, is essentially what the Game Lab here is based off. You have 2 semesters, a demo path and a game path. And then demo path, you have a series of gates that you as the participant has to go through. Often at the first gate, they're expecting you to come up with a game concept and maybe a game demo. Then second gate, you have to have a game demo. And at the third gate, you have the demo to such an extent that you can say, hey, this is what we want to do on the game path. And as you go through each gate, your team increases, the skill you get increases. And as a developer there and student, you get so much more freedom to actually do things and do what you want. Of course, this is an entertainment game, not really a serious game. But that's my curriculum that I followed. It won't be anything that you guys will be doing, but there's still the experience you get when developing a serious game is still applicable to entertainment games. I was there with several others that I studied with. They're all still here through the fourth year as well. Overall, the experience we've gathered there is incredible. We've got people from all over the world now that we know in Finland, in the US. I got so many more connections. I was able to go to several big game development industries and events to actually talk with people there. I currently actually work for one of those people, so that's great. Anything else you wanted to know from me, or that you guys want to know from me? Because the OGL works together with the Hanse here, so I got to know about them, and the education there, game design-wise, has been very much advertised here and is considered one of the best game educations in the world. They actually got awarded that in 2017 while I was there, which was very exciting. There was one thing you guys wanted to know from me of why I started this education, right? So when I was in HAVO, I was in my fifth year, and I still didn't quite know what I wanted to do for my HBO. And I happened to walk across game design during a Hans Open day, and I thought, yeah, I like games, I like talking about games, I like what goes on behind games. Let's give this education a shot, see if it isn't anything for me, then I'll see if I can find anything else. About 2 weeks into the education, I was like, yeah, this is for me. I want to go through with this. And I'm now part of the PR team. I've been a student representative. I'm part of Glitch. And I've gone abroad. Something I recommend to everyone, by the way. Go abroad for your minor.
All right. Thanks, Robin. If you have... Give an applause. If you have questions later on, Robin and Geert will be available to talk to you in English or Dutch. As you saw by a brief spoiler, I have some more videos of products that students made in their second year. And later on, I will turn it on here and you can go here and see some more. But now I'd like to give my word to Nick. And I think it's enough listening and time for some action.
Time for some doing. Yeah. So we've been talking a lot about the actual information in this program, about study associations, about student counselors, and we thought, how cool would it be if we could actually let the students show their parents what an actual lesson on game design is about? So, sorry for the parents, but tonight you're going to be joining a workshop which we call Mini-Pawn, and your sons or daughter will... help you with that, help you in that process. And what we're going to do is analyze a game that we came up with. And we're basically asking you as the game designers, because you're all game designers for one evening right now, to make a better version out of it. Because we came up with a game called Mini-Pawn. And in the game Mini-Pawn, two players have one particular goal. The goal is to reach the other side of the playing field. So this is the game. As you might see, it's very similar to chess, and it's very similar to checkers. And it is a field of 3x3 squares, right? So in total, 9 squares. And every player has 2 pawns, right? So player 1 has 2 pawns, player 2 has 2 pawns. The same rules as in chess also apply. So in turns, players can move their piece, their pawn, forward. And then the other player is up. What you can also do with a pawn is capture another player, right? And the only way in which you can capture another player is by striking them diagonally. So it means that you pull your piece from this bottom right corner, put it on top of the green one, get away with the green piece, and then move your red piece in the middle square. Afterwards, obviously, the green player is up and can also strike and capture another pawn. But my question to the audience is, what is wrong with mini-pawn? Because this is a game, right? Students? Guy? No? It's over now? Yeah. Okay, it's over now. Okay. Isn't this a game? Am I wrong? Nobody wins? Yeah? Yeah, what is the other problem that we see? Is it like a full game? Is it a long game or is it a very short session? Or it's pretty boring, right? Yeah. Okay, I must admit this wasn't the most interesting game that I could come up with. The game very quickly ends in stalemates, right? Nobody can win. At a certain moment, there's actually only one dominant strategy, right? If you do one thing. It means that you can win, and if you do anything else, it means that you're in a draw, right? You're both not the winner. So in game design, we call this that the problem with game balance, right? The balance of the game to make it fun and interesting is really off. The next step, though, as a game designer, is not saying, "Hey, this game is not working. Let's throw it away." Right? The job of the game designer is really to understand what is wrong with the game and propose certain fixes to make it better. Because if we cannot even improve Minipawn, how would we be able to improve any other more complex game, right? Like the examples that we saw before. And we're really using Minipawn to show you as parents, but also show the students, what kind of steps you can take in a game where something is going wrong and where you need to change something. Of course, just changing things isn't necessarily the purpose, because you also need to ensure that you understand why you change certain things. We always ask the students, hey, keep track of the changes that you're making. Write down any problems that you see with the game. Test it very often with your fellow students to ensure that the game is fun and engaging. So what we also want you to do in this assignment is keep track of a so-called evaluation log. And this evaluation log is basically a list of the problems that you saw on the left-hand side. So you just write them down with a piece of paper and a pen. And the fix that you have proposed, right? So you can change the game. You could, for example, make the board bigger to ensure that it doesn't end in a stalemate. Or you could add more pieces, right? So you could add additional pawns. So an observation could be, hey, after a few turns, players can't really move anymore, right? So let's try maybe a 4x4 board. The cool thing is, normally, as a lecturer, we do this every day, right? We provide challenging assignments to students, and we try to help them overcome certain problems. The benefit of one of these parents' nights is that I have a bunch of students here right now, and they're all very good at this, right? So what we've done, we've prepared a lot of tables behind the front office over here, outside of the workshop, or outside of this classroom, sorry. And there's materials there. What we would ask of you is sit down over there, together with your son or daughter, and recreate the game Minipawn in the basic version, and start playing it, and start seeing, hey, what could we improve, and what could we change and adapt to make it more engaging, more fun? I think I will be there, all my other fellow colleagues will be there. So if you have any other questions regarding the program or any other questions regarding perhaps the future of game designers, do not hesitate, come and talk to us. I think all staff tonight is Dutch, so that's a benefit. So it means that you could also ask your questions in Nederlands. And beside that, I'd say let's ensure that we get to work. Yeah.
Ja, maar dat is niet altijd aanpassen.